What up, everybody? This is Jason Lee, and this is Hollywood Unlocked Uncensored, and I'm here with
it's just me, Melissa Ford, aka the Curve Queen, and we have a special guest host in the studio with us tonight.
Chuck, it's your boy Chuck. Yeah. Chuck Walton. Yeah. Chuck the Plug. Charlie Hustle. I got all kind of nicknames. You niggas, know, it all depends what you need.
When niggas are on probation, that's what happens. you know, a lot of people keep asking, you know, what happened to Doughboy? What happened to Giovanni? What happened? So right now, just to kind of put it out there, we're rotating the third seat because we're trying to find someone that can live in the seat permanently. Not a squatter, not somebody who has rental history that's not good. Somebody that has
good work ethic. My bill's paid, baby. Bill's paid.
Yeah, so it's, you know, somebody that's funny because I feel like I'm funny in a weird way. What the fuck is going on? Okay, I'm funny in a weird way. But we need somebody who's just funny, energetic, and not to say that the others aren't. We want to fill it out before we have a permanent roommate. Does that make sense?
It makes perfect sense. So that's what we're doing. We're doing this rotation thing. And then at you as the viewer and listener, we actually want your input. And people have been very vocal about who they like and who they don't like.
Yes.
People have liked Giovanni, and I'll just kind of leave it right there.
Y'all motherfuckers have sounded off. They've sounded off on Doughboy. He ain't coming back.
Okay, well, there it is, Jason.
But anyway, shout out to Doughboy. Hopefully everything's working out in his career. So let's talk about our weekend and recap. Melissa, what did you do this weekend?
Well, I was with you. Wasn't I with you? I don't even remember.
It feels like we're always together, but
it's like a blur.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just a blur. So much has happened. I mean, the Republic National Convention.
We're not talking about that. We're talking about your weekend.
I know, but it's hard to remember where the hell you were because of everything that was happening. I don't remember.
Chuck,
we were bike riding.
So talk about that.
We were bike riding with Floyd and the crew. That's always fun. Good G-rated fun.
Well, I showed up on time. Melissa absolutely caught the wrong location.
That was not my fault.
Okay, but then you got in a car accident. There's a lot of things that happen to you that you don't want to talk about. She was rear-ended, no pun intended.
Yeah. I don't know what they were doing behind me, but, you know, they weren't.
No pun intended.
Yeah, they weren't paying attention. They
no pun intended.
Definitely weren't. I think there was a little bit of, you know, like circle jerk action happening in that car.
Circle jerk behind you.
That's okay.
Circle jerk behind Melissa Ford. That's
definitely. It's not the first time. It definitely won't be the last.
That's what he said. So did the person that hit you have insurance? Because I got hit the last time. I got hit, that motherfucker had all kinds of insurance. I got 50 G's out of him. Shout out to the guy who hit me on Sunset. I can't remember his name.
I have a feeling that her insurance was expired.
Why?
Yeah.
Why do you have a feeling? Are you profiling?
Because no. It wasn't a profile. It was a black guy driving, Asian girl in the passenger seat. But I get the idea. It was her car, which is why there was like some, you know, whatever was going on in the car and stuff. She sounded very funny.
Speaking of black and Asian, we have Kevin McCall coming in. We'll be talking about Karrueche for sure.
Karrueche.
And we just heard the song.
Okay.
That he can sing.
The last thing I would say in response to your accent, anytime somebody hits you from behind, you need to get paid.
Yeah, you know.
There was a joke in there. Somebody hit you from behind, you should get paid. That was some hoe shit I was on for a minute. Never mind.
I'm sorry. It just went right over my head. You know what? I didn't want to deal with it. I really wasn't hurt. And I've gone through, you know, the whole car accident thing when I was actually really, really hurt. And it was so stressful. Listen, I'm living. If you are looking at my Snapchat right now, I am living very stress free. I'm half naked in my jacuzzi at night.
What is your Snapchat?
My Snapchat is Melissa Ford. My name, MelyssaFord. Into it because you're missing out.
Are people sending you dick pictures?
Yes. Oh, dick pictures. I'm getting video of guys jerking off. I'm like, but here's the thing.
Send them to me.
I'm going to send them to you. Okay. And please don't do that because, you know, I sent out a tweet the other day. I was like, dick pics with my coffee. What a way to start a Tuesday.
But what if it's a really nice dick picture?
I don't give a fuck. I don't care. Listen, okay. Like every once in a while you come across a piece of art, you know, a penis that is just perfect. But listen, okay. If I don't know the guy that it's attached to, just leave me the, listen, don't send me dick pics, please.
Okay.
Your love in other ways. No dick pics.
We'll create a Snapchat forwarder and you can just forward that to me. So check. What about your weekend?
Well, my weekend didn't have any dick pics in my Snapchat.
Lucky me.
No, I was doing the
just for the record for the viewers, you're straight.
I'm straight. Okay. Oh yeah, we got to let people know these days.
I mean, this show.
I am straight. I'm very straight.
Well, we still accept you for who you are.
That's actually how I bumped into Melissa. I saw her from the back at the SB after party, and I was the whole time I was like, damn, I was like, who is this? So then I saw Eddie George, and then I was like, oh, wait a minute. I thought Eddie was married, but I didn't know she was with Eddie.
No, wait, so, hold on. Whoa. Wait. Let's clear that up because now.
Because SWV will drop a single when they hear this.
Yeah, let's clear that up right now. Eddie George and I have been very good friends for the last 13
I
years.
Love Eddie.
That is it.
Shout out to EG.
That is all. I didn't come with him. He was at the party. I saw him with other people. I was with my girl.
And Eddie George is a married man to my friend Taj from SWV.
Yes. And he happily married.
Shout out to Taj.
He's a happily married man. He is just a friend of mine. I support him in his Broadway career, acting career, etc.
Yeah.
And one so we just happen to be standing there talking with him, Mitch Richmond, John Sally was there. Can you please Big list John. The other guys that were Mitch in the Richmond. Circle?
Michael Mann was there.
Yeah.
So it was group activity.
It was group activity. But really? In my mind,
I'm saying that in a
PG the fuck up,
way.
Jason.
Okay. So go ahead.
So all I just see is this black dress, and then boom, I'm like, oh my God. So and I had some drinks in me. I'm about to leave the party. Then I turned around. So I saw Eddie. Then I turned around and I was like, oh my God, that's Melissa Ford. So then Michael Mann, they were like, yeah, you want to meet her? So then I was like, hell yeah. And then before I could meet her, she turned around and she was like, are you a comedian? And I was like, I would be whatever if I could just talk to you for 2 seconds. Then she told me about the show, and history is now in the making.
Well, so, good. Yeah. Let me tell you how good it is to be best friends with Melissa Ford. Like, I know, I'm not really popping. Like, I live in reality. Like, I know I'm on a TV show that's popping, but I'm not a popping cast member. I had a pop-off last season that made me pop a little bit, but I'm not popping. Boy, you hang out with Melissa, you get all kinds of attention. So I literally just feed off of her fame and all the people interested in her. And
you get all the love.
I get all the leftovers. But I fuck with Melissa. And so, yeah, I'm glad that you were able to come and be a part of this ridiculous-ass show.
I love the show, by the way.
Do you?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's fucking...
R.I.P. to Dope Boy, but I love the show.
My new favorite person.
Okay. Yeah.
So my weekend, I'm just going to tell a really quick story that I shared a little bit before we got online. So, you know, I should work for the ASPCA,
yes, because you like to pick up strays. Yes,
I tend to because I can't find anybody that wants to be consistent in my life or that I can be consistent with because I work in travel life.
Yeah,
because
you keep dating all these babies, all these young little men.
So we'll continue along.
Okay.
So I went to Nick Cannon's party last week, and I was in there for a couple purposes. One, of course, I wanted to see if my future lover was there. And two, I wanted to show support to Nick Cannon because we were trying to get Nick on the show. Nick, stop bullshit and get in here. We need to talk about the wedding papers or the marriage papers. But anyway.
And chili.
So I meet somebody, then I'm like, you know, I'm going to take y'all to dinner. So I take them, my team, we go to dinner. Really nice place, Boa. And I learned a lot in this dinner. I learned that you should invest in 401ks. You should invest in IRAs, but you should never invest in a fucking stray dog. So after $600 dinner, I had this young person trying to network with me. And here's the deal. For people out there that want to network in Hollywood, sometimes just being in the room is enough. Sometimes just being around at the beginning is enough.
There's a difference between persistence and thirst.
There's a difference between being hungry and being thirsty.
Yeah, that too.
Right?
That too. But you're right. Sometimes just being in the room is awesome enough. Just sit, listen to what's going on, observe, and that's it.
Why should it took these motherfuckers to a trough instead of a boa? Because they were so thirsty and started going down all the names. You know, people on our YouTube say, y'all name drop a lot. Listen, you simple motherfuckers that don't hang with the people we do. You talk about your friend Becky and Sue. We talk about our friend Floyd and
whoever else.
So don't be mad at my lifestyle. But anyway, I digress. So this motherfucker started networking and telling me all the people that he knew. And finally, I just snapped. Not pretty much. I paid the bill. I did pay the bill, but I will probably never see that person again.
That's awful.
You snapped him in half?
No, I didn't snap him in half. If he would have said another word, I probably would have. But what I just basically said was...
You got stalked in on him.
Motherfucker, stop telling me who you know. Like, I get it. You know everybody. Even though the people he knew were like... I'm just going to leave it alone. You know, filler people. You know, people that fill the room at parties.
Like B-side people.
C-list.
No, I'm talking about like, you know, an album. The A-side and the B-side. The B-side was always the songs that nobody really gave a fuck about.
Pretty much that.
You know, so I find that about LA. Everyone's got to talk about who they know, what they do, and this, that. And I'm like, I didn't ask, motherfucker.
Better than that, we don't give a fuck. But here's the funny part. Yeah. And my guys will tell you. The other guy with him was like, yo, bro. Like, I'm Queen Latifah's cousin. I was like, oh, really? Because that's like my sister. So I'm like, what's her phone number? You know, what's the prefix? 424. Nah, 732. You don't know her. Okay. So anyway, so all of you out there that, and all of you out there that want to network, like, it's cool to network. At Nick Cannon's party, some guy came up to me. He was like, "Yo, bro, oh my God, I love your work." I said, "What's my name?" And he goes, "John." I said, "No, motherfuckers, you don't know my name. Don't talk to me like you know me." Mm. And he was like, "Well, I mean, I know who you are. Well, if you know who I am well enough to come up and be like, yo, bro, then you should know my name." This other girl walks up. She's like, "Hey, boo, hey, boo." And I'm like, "What's my name?" She's like, "I succeeded." So part of mm-hmm. it was like, damn, nobody knows me. The other part was, come on, motherfuckers. Like, let's not fake it out here. If you want to know somebody, if you see their face, Google them. If you can think, like, if I see somebody and I think I know them, I mean, I'll Google or whatever. Not that I do it anymore, but I used to. Mm. I don't know.
Land of make-believe. This is the land of, you know, trimmed trees, manicured lawns. Everything just looks so pretty and perfect and shit like that.
It really isn't.
Mm-mm. It goes down in the wild, wild west.
Boo and bro is like the way, like, do say hello to somebody you don't know, but you think you should say hello to?
Oh, I stopped her dead sentence in front of everybody. I said, the only people that say boo to me is somebody I'm fucking and somebody that's crying. Boo hoo. So you don't know me. She was like, oh my God, you're so aggressive. I go,
knew anything about you, she would already know that.
So a third girl walked up and she was like, Jason Lee, oh my God, so good to see you. And I said, see, that's why I'm not fucking with y'all. And I did an interview with her and she was really cool. And like, I'm not on no ego shit. Like, if you don't know me, it's cool. A lot of people don't know me. That's fine. But at least don't act like you know me and then try to politic with me. That's just not going to happen. Mm.
The t-shirt says it all, though. That's all I need to know. It's TNT.
Money team.
Basically.
The money team.
Shout out to Floyd for keeping the lights on.
Shout out to Floyd. We had a good time with him this weekend.
Floyd is exhausting because here's the deal. People that have never had it, like people that are excited and they want to hang with Floyd Mayweather, like you have to have endurance. You have to have stamina. You have to be able to like really... Whenever Floyd's in town, just know like that 48 or 72 hours is no sleep.
No sleep.
Yeah. Mm-mm. No. You have to like, you know what? You have to sleep like a cow, like standing up. Just get like a little micro sleep in. Yeah, and then we're moving.
Yeah, one eye open. Sleep with one eye open.
Well.
No. Sleep standing up. Like find a pillar. Like if you're in the mall, just find a pillar just to lean up against. Get like a little micro sleep.
Lean back.
Like they laugh at me because I find like if we're in the car heading to the mall, I'll sleep. Or if we're at a restaurant and we're waiting on our food, I'll sleep. Because that's really the only time you get to sleep. There is no other sleep. As soon as you get to the house, strippers get there, party turns on, music, DJ, like, you know.
Or everybody will pile into the cars and the Sprinter van and go to Long Beach so that he can get a facial and we all go to Bubba Gump Shrimp.
No, that literally just happened.
That just happened. It was all over my Snapchat. I'm telling you, if you're not looking at my Snapchat, you're missing out. It's antics.
So Floyd was getting a facial.
While we were getting dinner.
While we were eating Bubba Gump Shrimp.
Shout out to the jambalaya fucking Bubba Gums. That shit was good.
That was really, really good. Me and Jason both had matching bibs.
So the other day we're at Katsuya, right? And we're eating and I said to her, I said, I put her on my Snapchat. I said, okay, every time she snaps, I'm going to say something inappropriate. So I turn it to her and she starts to talk. She's like, yeah. And I said, suck dick. My Snapchat is funny. I am Jason Lee. Follow me. What's your Snapchat?
Sir Chuck Walton, WALTON. Oh, my snaps are like movies. I haven't even snapped today. I'm waiting for Kevin McCall to get here, mm-hmm. and I'm hoping, because he might be a little bit crazy, I'm hoping that I get a couple snaps in, not just one. See, and then
his Twitter, you know what? I can't wait to meet the man behind that Twitter account, because...
We want
to
know the real.
I just want to know if he's on lithium ever.
Let me say this. Kevin McCall is literally, he's a Leo.
Okay, well, that explains a lot.
He's a close friend of mine.
That explains a lot.
He's a creative person.
That explains a lot.
Hold on. And he's from Watts.
Enough said.
That's the first thing I saw.
Put all that recipe together. That's an explosive motherfucker. But he's smart. He's cool. But he just is over the Hollywood shit.
Smart, cool, incredibly talented.
Like crazy.
And well, I mean, you know what?
Y'all sat me right next to him.
Genius breeds eccentricity.
Y'all both brown skin. He ain't not gonna do nothing to you. I'm a light skin motherfucker.
You're right. You're right. You're right.
I'm light skin. Am I not light skin right now?
Yeah, you're light skin.
Okay, I got to get back on the deck and tan a little bit more.
Yeah,
my base is fading.
You've been on the deck a lot. And you know what I forgot? When I was in Miami a couple weeks ago, I actually was in the gift shop with the team and we were buying things.
Gift shop where?
Inside the Fountain Blue.
Okay, this is promising.
And I found something for you, a gift.
Okay.
Because I feel like I never really show you my appreciation for you.
I'm so excited. I just went down the list. It's not anal beads.
No.
It's not a dildo.
Nope.
Not Chinese balls. Is it anything sexual?
Listen, Let me do let me do this presentation, okay?
Strap on.
So when I thought about you, when we first started this show.
I actually want one of those.
Hold on, let's bring it back.
A strap okay, on? Sorry, sorry. Yes, I do.
When I first when Don't we first started this show,
yeah.
You were on Tinder, swiping left and right, trying to find a man.
Did you get me a fucking membership to Soul Swipe?
Then Soul Swipe reached out to us, wanted to work with us. That shit hasn't happened yet. Mm. Plus, you don't really dip into chocolate.
Hey. I will show you the chocolate motherfucker that I want right now.
And then now you and I have been talking, and I know you've been having, you know, you've been a little in your feelings about being single, and you're getting to the age where you want to be a mom, right?
I don't, okay, yeah. Yeah.
And
okay.
I feel, this is the one thing that I feel.
Motherfucker, what did you get me? This prenatal is the one, pills?
No, this is the one thing that I believe that, like, in order to be a good husband or a good wife, you need to know how to give head. So I got you something.
What makes you think I don't know how to give head, motherfucker? Kind of, what'd you hear?
I was low-key thinking to myself when I got this gift because if you're going to give head, you got to give head to something really big. So listen, you get to... you need. You're not on the air. Calm down. You need to practice. So I got you this. Here.
Is that a real lollipop?
That is a real fucking sucker. You can literally take the paper off and lick it right now.
Are we getting a live demonstration?
If she does, we're definitely slow-moing this for the audience.
Wait, I need scissors because there is a...
No, we need this on the Snapchat.
There's scissors.
So for people who can't... So for people on the radio listening to this train wreck of an interview...
We need to get some scissors in there. We got to get this on the
I got Melissa a huge blow pop.
Don't worry. It will be on my Snapchat. That will make you guys follow. And I will post it on Instagram.
But if you lick it, you have to make it slow-mo on your Snapchat.
I'm going to go to town on this sucker.
That's what he said.
Yes, and that is what she said.
So let's talk about the Republican National Convention.
They had you that hot that you couldn't even get it up.
I tend to think of myself more as like a... not... an independent. I mean, mm-hmm. even though I sway more towards being a liberal and a Democrat because I believe all the values that they stand for. Like, mm-hmm. I'm for that. And everything I've done in my past life in politics has been towards the Democrat. Mm-hmm. But with Obama, he kind of tried to, I think even though he was a Democrat, he got a lot of Republican support because he really, you know, I think touched on the millennials and what was moving young people mm-hmm. at the time. These fucking Republicans.
It's called bipartisanship.
These fucking Republicans are out of control and need to be stopped. I know that Connor is a Republican because I've watched his Snapchat and that shit. You know, he has white privilege in his life, so that I understand. That was a joke, Connor. I still love you. I'm really Melania. Let's start with Melania.
Okay, hold on. I'm gonna preface this by saying that I specifically avoided watching a lot of the RNC coverage just because I just didn't want to make myself angry. Like, know thine enemy, whatever the fuck. But I literally could not stomach watching and listening to these hypocrites, to Governor Chris Christie, the governor over in New Jersey, who I actually used to like a lot. Rudy Giuliani. I mean, these are politicians who have been, you know, very controversial, but you've seen their, you know, their policies, you know, put into action and actually, you know, create good comes of it. Listening to them talk was inflammatory. It was like making me so angry. I was like, I couldn't even go there. So let's talk about Melania.
So I think one thing, did you watch any of it?
I saw some of it. I felt the same way. It was just, it was a travesty to watch. It looked like it was the worst RNC in a long time, if not ever, to me. I mean, it was ridiculous.
A lot of the young people don't really remember, like, you know, I'm up there a little bit. So I remember Ronald Reagan. Mm. I remember the Clintons when they were in office for two terms and all the Bushes. And now Obama. So I've kind of been around a little bit, not as long as maybe some people that are watching, but, you know, for me to see Melania Trump basically give a speech that plagiarized Michelle Obama's speech, mm-hmm. this is, and what people are saying, like, okay, well, she plagiarized or she was inspired by it. No, check this out. She not only stole the first lady's speech, who's still in office mm-hmm. and is a Democrat, but this is the same family that they criticized and said that Obama was an American and attacked her and attacked both of them and their values and their belief system, but yet were so inspired that they stole her speech. That shit to me was so frustrating to watch. And I think what's even more irritating to me is how dare people still even talk about them being qualified to be in the White House.
Yeah. Not only that, Trump sends out a tweet basically saying that, you know, regardless of the plagiarism or whatever, just forget all of that. Melania had the most watched speech or blah, 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 whatever the case was. I was just like, but how about this? So did Michelle Obama, because you had to watch hers in order to compare the fact that it was so heavily copied. So in essence, yeah, she might have had the most watched speech in political history or whatever the case was. But then again, so did Michelle Obama. Like, you just, he just, like, he's such a spin doctor, and it's just nauseating to listen to him talk.
Where's Melania from?
Slovenia, I think.
That's what got me is that, like, Trump is, like, trying to keep people from coming in, but then his wife is, like, not even from
she
here
needs
either.
To be
is
on
an
the
immigrant
first,
and a porn star.
She needs to be on the first fucking boat back to whatever country she comes from. Let me go down the list. Superhead, Amber Rose, Black China, all bitches that can be the first lady at this point. Yeah. I feel like if you're going to strip it all down and take it all off, I have seen Amber Rose's, I've seen her uterus, vagina.
Meat
her,
curtains.
I think I've even seen, yeah, I've seen everything. You're stupid.
In person?
No, on media takeout. But anyway, I think that, like, for me, the office of the president and his family should have a certain level of class. You know, think about diplomacy. Think about our relationship with the world. We are the country. We are the strongest country in the world. Our president is the leader of the free world. And in order to, I think, be the face of freedom and all those other things, like, how can you send your wife in whose pussy has been all over the internet? I just don't understand that. How do you go from Michelle Obama to this woman who can
barely speak English?
You said, took the words right out of my
barely
mouth.
Barely speak English.
I think that was the first time that America got a visual of, like, what could be. Like, this is what you guys want. Like, she could barely speak English. She's all over the web. You know, they tried to freeze them out. It was so much craziness going on. It was like a joke. It was like watching Bullworth or something.
I think it's good
analogy.
It was like Bullworth. It was literally like watching Bullworth.
Yeah. I don't know what Bullworth is.
It was a movie back in the day. It was like a parody or kind of a satire on Warren Beatty. Yeah, Warren Beatty and Halle Berry.
Halle Berry.
Yeah. A million years ago.
Really?
Yeah, you gotta see it.
I missed that one.
Ghetto Superstar, Maya song. That was
let me say that what I think it is it's an embarrassment. If you think about how intelligent, and I don't give a fuck what you think about the Obamas. You can be a Republican and think, okay, the Obamas and Democrats have, you know, whatever. I'm not even going to run down the list of the things that they've done, but more importantly, I think they've reinstilled class in our government and around the world coming off of Bush. Mm-hmm. So we could potentially have Donald Trump and Melania Trump as our president and first lady. It's crazy.
Don't even want to think about that.
Now, you said you remember.
I'm Canadian.
Oh, wow. Yeah. You don't even want to think about that. Mm. So you remember, like, the Reagan, the Clinton, the Bush, when they were having the conventions. Do you think that if this happened before social media was so big, that it would have been, like,
I don't think Trump would have gotten as far as he has if it wasn't for social media.
The problem is. The problem with this country, the problem with this city, the problem with this fucking world. Social media, social fame, you know, instant recognizability resonates with people more than politics. You'll have an unstable motherfucker who can barely... I mean, he's not had a stable marriage. He has 3,000 lawsuits. You have a motherfucker that can say, get all Muslims out of our country or ban them. 1.3 billion people become the leader of the free world. So he's attacked North Korea. He's weighed in on Russia. He's flip-flopped.
He wants to build this wall. Have you seen his Hollywood walk?
Hold on. Okay. He's flip-flopped on politics. I mean, on international relation topics that, you know, like, not Libya and all those other countries. But anyway, he's flip-flopped on issues that I think could bring big problems to our country.
Well, he's flip-flopped on everything. I saw an article that said, I think he told People magazine in 1998 that if he were to run, he would run as a Republican because they were the dumbest voters. So he knew.
Yeah, that's kind of everywhere. And it's up for debate as to whether or not it's, like, it's legit. Real or legit.
If that motherfucker said it was raining outside and we see the sun, I would believe it because he's that fucking dumb. And you know who's even more stupid? And I love her. She's a friend. I'm going to say it. Is Omarosa. I feel like Omarosa should have, you know, she's been criticized in the past for not having integrity, for being, you know, just an embarrassment, I think, to some. And I find her personally charming. And I know she's intelligent as fuck. But I don't understand why Omarosa would step up other than for positioning or loyalty to Donald, not loyalty to the American or American people. Mm-hmm. Why she would step up and represent all African Americans or want to do outreach for Donald Trump to African Americans. That's just, to me, just super backwards. You know Omarosa.
Yeah, no, I know Omarosa, and I agree with you. Like, you know, knowing her personally, she is super charming. She is she's a really nice woman personally. I think that there is who she is personally, and then there's her public persona. And I think that at some point, you know, in her career, you know, being on TV, she embraced being the villain. She was very, very, very good at it. But this is confusing to me. Like, this is, Omarosa, we want you on the show. We want to have a really big, long
conversation. Why is it confusing to you, though?
Because, for the exact same reasons that you just said. You know, like, the pivot was just so, I mean, is it like a need for relevance to bring yourself back into the fold and into the public eye? Because this sets her up for so much criticism. Did you see what Spike Lee said about her?
No, what did he say?
Yeah, Spike went off.
Spike went off. It was either Twitter, Instagram, or both. But he basically said step and fetch, you know, called her like a coon.
Yeah.
You know,
and
told her to join the ranks with, like, you know, Ben Carson and that police chief who, which one was he from? Was that Florida?
Florida?
Not the Dallas one, the Florida one. Yeah, that was, I can't.
Whatever.
Yeah.
But well, I think at the end of the day, look, I've never been a coon. I've never been a step and fetch it type of person. Mm. You know, I'm not going to say, I don't understand. And I'm confused as to why Omarosa, who, you know, who had a little bit of respect, is now choosing to lose it over this loser. Wait. Hold on, let me finish. Okay. Omarosa has to come on this show and talk about it, because we will continue to talk about her. Her mother works at Marshall's in the Valley. Is she now going to have to quit her job because people are going to know that Omarosa is out in the public eye?
Right.
Well, yeah. Shout out to all the people working at Marshall's.
I mean, why didn't he just hire Stacey Dash to run his African American relations or whatever the title is?
And I don't know why Trump would think that, like, with all due respect to Omarosa, I don't know why he thought that she had this relationship with the black community where she would be some type of person that everybody would just.
She's a Baptist preacher.
Well, yeah. That's about it.
Well, I'm Pentecostal. So, I mean.
Are you Pentecostal?
I am. Church of God in Christ, absolutely.
Fire and brimstone? Wow. I don't get that from you.
Fallout. I mean, I don't shout.
Cats
of
spirit and shit.
Listen,
rolling on
back
the floor.
To Omarosa.
I need to fucking see that shit.
Back. I don't care. I don't do all that. But back to Omarosa. I think it's for me. I'm embarrassed because I do consider Omarosa a friend. I just am really confused at how she's come to the decision of being the face of the African American community or outreaching to us for Trump.
If you were tight with Donald Trump like that and he asked you to take that position.
Fuck no. Mm-mm. I have friends that make stupid decisions all the time. And you know what? I'm a real friend. If you just on some other shit. No, I just interviewed Claudia Jordan at Essence Festival, who was on Celebrity Apprentice, who's friends with Donald Trump, mm-hmm. who's hosted Miss Universe or one of those fucking pageants that he owned. And she said she's going to support whoever will allow Muslims to stay in this country. She still wouldn't take a hard line against Donald, but she was definitely saying that she's not fucking with him. I think that you can still be diplomatic towards your friend, but also keep it 1,000. Like, Omarosa is not going to reach one black person, maybe other than Ben Carson and his ugly ass wife.
Yeah. Oh my God.
His wife looks like a woolly mammoth. If you've ever Googled a woolly mammoth, Ben Carson, he's a fucking doctor. He needs to go do surgery on that bitch.
So what is his wife on the 1 to 10 scale?
What?
She's a minus fucking 100. And
she doesn't even rank.
There's a video of her singing a church hymn and she's like, oh, she looks so fucking ridiculous that if she would have been our first lady, I absolutely would have funded an assassination attempt. Put that bitch out of her misery.
Oh my God, Jason. Oh,
so anyway, shout out to Omarosa. Bring your ass on the show. Talk to real black people because we're going to have a real conversation. I would love to see Omarosa on our show and our other friend Karen Civil, who's working with Hillary Clinton, mm-hmm. doing the same thing, to sit down and let's have a real conversation.
Yeah, that would be very interesting because both women are so intelligent, and it wouldn't be like a bitch kind of like argument. It would be very intelligent. It would be it would basically be a battle of wits.
Yeah,
you know, from opposing sides. I would love to be. To sit here and watch that go down.
So another hot topic that's out there right
now. Another black man got shot.
And I'll just transition to this. There's another black man, unarmed black man in Miami that was shot by police. He is a therapist who was helping to
retrieve an autistic patient.
And he was shot by police with his hands up. And when he was shot,
laying on the ground.
Charles Kinsey.
Can I get it? Let me get it out, people.
Sorry.
He was shot. And then when he asked the police officer why he shot him, he said, I don't know. So how is Omarosa going to reach out to that community, the Black Lives Matter campaign, and even act like Donald Trump gives a fuck?
Well, here's the problem. Like, it's so much deeper than that. I mean, like, Rudy Giuliani basically went on record during his speech at the RNC and basically called Black Lives Matter like a terrorist organization or something like that. Like, he just, I don't, why did, I... I'm sorry. That is the definition of a loss for words.
Well, what got me was they said after they shot him, they handcuffed him and left him bleeding for 20 extra minutes. So,
well, there's another. And you know what's so crazy? This is what's so crazy. Nothing's going to happen. Like I said on our last show that I empathize with people, with the people who killed those police officers, because I can understand the anger. When you get to a point to where, damn, I can have my hands up, I can be in my car with my license and still get shot and killed or shot like an animal and nothing can happen. I went to this event the other day, Occupy City Hall, and mm-hmm. all of these people got together, celebrities there, Marlon Wayans, Devon Franklin, Megan Good,
Lance
Eva,
Gross was there.
Kevin was there. Mm-hmm. We can talk to him about that. All these celebrities were there, Kimberly Elise. But the demand was get rid of the chief of police. You cannot tell the city to fire the chief of police. There would have to be so much that goes into that. And politically, once you take a position to fire somebody, they're not going to do it because then it just totally creates a problem for the government. Mm. You know, and I think that, you know, we have to have strong policies or strong policy recommendations or actions, because right now, like the fact that you can go get a bag of Skittles, be shot because you have a hood on. You can be driving in a car with your girl, get asked to pull out your license, get shot and killed. You can be a therapist with an autistic patient and get shot and still no accountability is fucking crazy to me.
It really is. It really is. Like I saw the video today and I just was, it's going to get to the point where apathy starts to set in. You know, if it hasn't already, it just is. And that's frightening. Apathy is scarier than hate, than anger, than fear, than love, than whatever.
Or you're going to have fucking anarchy like another police shooting that just happened last week in Louisiana where three police mm-hmm. officers were killed. Mm-hmm. People are going to get tired of being treated like animals and they're going to start fighting back. And you know what's going to happen is on one hand, you're going to have a group that get apathetic with all of the violence and just say, fuck it, there's nothing we can do. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you're going to have people that are going to say, fuck it, we're going to Bloods and Crips, we're going to gang up and go shoot these motherfuckers because they're a gang too. Mm-hmm. So we're going to go shoot these police and innocent police are going to get killed. One of the officers that was killed, I think his name was, I can't remember his name, but he was African-American in Louisiana. Mm-hmm. He had posted on his social media after the Dallas shootings how he was trying to make sense of it all, how he just wants to be a good officer, how officers need to be accountable. He mm-hmm. went on and on. Have you seen it?
Yeah, and he had a little, I think he had just had a baby or something.
Just
like
had a baby.
He mm-hmm. had a kid.
He got murdered.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the worst part. So it's funny because I had like a beef with somebody on my Instagram page because I posted a picture of one of the officers, the Dallas officers that was shot. You know, he was Hispanic. He just had another, his wife had just had another baby. He served in the military and stuff like that. I was just like, It is not a us versus them kind of thing because there is just way too many people that wear the uniform that are good people that do not condone what the fuck is going on. So I posted this picture basically in support of the human being that lost his mm-hmm. life, the children who lost their father, and he's not the one that gunned any of these people. He didn't gun down Alton Sterling. He didn't gun down Philando Castile. He didn't gun down anybody. He wasn't responsible for any of it, but yet he lost his life. So I was basically just saying it's getting to the point where we've got to come up with...
But here's the frustrating...
Somebody was just on my page and they were just arguing with me because they just had that us versus them mentality. They called me a beautiful idiot. So I didn't really know how to feel about that, actually.
Well, let me tell you how I feel about this whole fucking thing. And I'm going to tie it up because I'm getting frustrated.
Okay.
Black people are also very pathetic. And I'm going to tell you why.
Okay.
You can't see a problem head on or look a problem in its face and not really put thought into how the fuck to deal with it, right? Mm-hmm. You have the Black Lives Matter movement and Occupy City Hall on one front saying, get rid of the chief. Then you got the game and Snoop on campaigns and PSAs supporting peace with the chief and the mayor. Mm-hmm. What the fuck are we doing?
Right.
The problem is that they know they can pick apart and dissect each of us because either A, on one hand, people are doing social posturing to mm-hmm. get in positions mm-hmm. to look mm-hmm. good or make money or profit or be involved somehow. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you have people who are being labeled radicals and who are being labeled as problematic people because they're coming at it from we're representing the people standpoint. Mm-hmm. I feel like somewhere, somebody or somehow these groups need to come together and make some fucking sense.
Exactly.
One more thing. Mm-hmm. Beyonce's mom, Tina Knowles, she was out there with Black Lives Matter. And mm-hmm. I saw her, I was like, oh shit, got to get Beyonce's mom on camera. Mm-hmm. So we interviewed her. Mm-hmm. She said, I've done a lot of research on Black Lives Matter, and a lot of people are trying to label them as a terror group or a hate group. Mm-hmm. And I believe in what they're doing because I've seen that all they stand for is advocating for the fact that black lives matter. Mm-hmm. And the way she just simplified it all, and her husband, Richard Lawson, said, you know, I've been around for a lot of these marches, and this is not a sprint. We can't just keep doing these really quick actions right. or activities. We have to understand that this marathon of change requires a lot of concerted activity. And I think that until us as black people can really take our own individual interests out of the equation and really focus on like how we unify
exactly.
a coalition, mm-hmm. it ain't gonna do shit. And we I'm gonna keep saying it ain't gonna do shit.
And we have to unify together first. We have to stay consistent too. You know, mm-hmm. consistency Absolutely. Is key because like people are gonna tweet about this guy getting shot and then before you know it, it's like, oh, well, he survived.
Well, then the game got into a big fight with Waka Flocka yesterday and people were like, if Black Lives Matter, why the fuck are y'all beefing on some stupid social media shit? Well,
why were they fighting? I missed that one.
Waka Flocka basically posted a video saying, I'm sick of all you rappers posting dick prints and all this other extra shit. Then you be on the Black Lives Matter shit and like y'all just all over the place.
Hilarious.
Game responded and then Waka Flocka said, look, I'm out walking my dog. I don't know what the fuck you talk about.
Oh, I did see that. I did say Waka Flocka, I wasn't even talking about you, but Game somehow, some way, Game took offense to that.
Black lives still matter.
Black lives still yeah. matter, and we know what Game's dick imprint looks like in
so
his shorts.
On that note, what up, everybody? This is Jason Lee from Hollywood Unlocked Uncensored, and we have a fellow Leo in the house, Kevin McCall.
Leo gang.
And you know Melissa. Have you ever met?
Oh, we have never met.
Really?
We've never met.
Oh.
No.
I thought it was this lady from the choir, from church, and then I was like, wait, that's not her. She really? Don't look that good.
Well, most men that have been with her, praise God afterwards, so.
Praise God. All hallelujah over here.
Amen.
Do it.
Mm-hmm. And this is our guest host. You can introduce
yeah,
yourself.
Yeah, Chuck, man. Me and Kevin, we see each other around. Yeah, okay. Yeah, we see him around town.
Dark-skinned niggas unite. Like, a light-skinned community, we do not know how to get along.
You sure don't.
Speaking of light-skinned people, shout out to Chris Brown. But
right out the gate,
he going right there.
No, you know, Kevin and I are both Leos. His birthday's coming up. I ran into him the other day at the Black Lives Matter event. You know,
yes,
a lot
you
of
did.
We've had another shooting since then. Did you hear about the guy in Miami that was shot yesterday?
I'm from Watts, so it's shootings every day.
But that's typically black on black crime, though.
Not necessarily.
Okay.
I'm Native American, so.
Are you really? Okay, so Kevin is full of shit today. Okay, I wanted to talk to Kevin because, you know, we like to talk about trending
yes,
topics.
You like to talk, you sure do, Jason. You're my brother, but you like to talk. Go
no,
ahead.
And you are very active on social media.
Constant trending topic.
Clearly,
constant
I like to
trending.
Talk
you're very active on Twitter. Extremely active on Twitter. That's how I feel like I know you. Yeah?
No, if you think you know me from Twitter, you don't know me at all.
Okay.
Well, I know you outside of Twitter. So I'm going to be the guy that knows you outside of Twitter. They know you on Twitter. So I wanted to just jump right in. So, okay, we're playing.
Or should we jump into all the ladies you introduced me to, the models, the...
We're not going to talk about you fucking Jordin Sparks or whatever sexual... Okay, so you guys didn't fuck her, did
you? Devil
is
a lie.
Okay. But you guys were sexually involved. It's okay. This is uncensored.
What are you talking about? No air. Right now, I don't have no air.
You left her with no air?
No, man.
We were actually talking about finger banging.
Y'all worse than the Breakfast Club.
We were talking
about finger. Is this how y'all get down?
Yeah.
We were talking
all right, I'm ready now. No shots, no Patron, no nothing.
No,
just right
we were
in.
Talking about finger banging earlier. So your relationship with Jordin Sparks. Let's talk about that. What? Because I introduced them. I'm thinking he does music, she does music.
Jason brokers a what lot of vagina in this town.
But they got together and then all of a sudden they made music.
Who?
Y'all didn't make a music that hit the air, but y'all made some music.
I never made music with Jordin Sparks.
Okay, so you were never sexually involved with her at all?
Never. I did make music with her one time.
Okay.
But Chris Brown was involved, and I don't do threesomes, so that ain't how I went.
Okay.
Okay, well, shout out to...
Wherever you going with it.
Shout out to Jordin. Okay, so... okay, so wait. Hold on.
So let's talk a little bit about...
She liked Jason Derulo, so...
That's
Does
okay.
She still?
She like guys that pop lock, and I'm too buff for that. So
okay, listen. wait, we're playing deuces. We're okay. playing deuces.
We are, but hold on. Listen, you're straight up no lubrication. Okay. Like, come on. Hold on 1 second.
Hey.
For our guests who don't know Kevin McCall, don't know anything about your history. Like, let's talk a little bit about the man behind the tweets, behind the controversy, and stuff like that. So you were
just really quickly.
Okay.
Nothing. Go ahead.
I'm just seeing where she going with this.
No, just personal history. You know, you played football while you were in college. You know, right. You're in the choir, you know, that kind of thing.
I was in
thing.
The choir and church and mm-hmm. stuff.
I mean, like, we just listened to Karrueche Mm-hmm. You have an amazing voice.
R&B singer, you know, yeah. grew up listening to like Tyrese. Mm-hmm. I actually used to go to his talent shows at Locke High School down the street.
Mm-hmm. Watts connection right there. Mm-hmm.
But
okay, so we're listening to Deuces.
That's all I have to say about Tyrese.
Deuces is playing under the interview for people on the radio that are listening. Deuces, as I came to know it, was the song that pretty much brought Chris Brown back from his fall from grace when he had the abuse situation with Rihanna. Mm-hmm. How did that song come about? Because I really don't know the history. I've never asked you.
It was a song I wrote about my first baby mama and my first love who broke up with me, and I felt like, you know, I don't know, they missed out on a good deal. So I wrote the song. I was feeling myself. Played it for Chris. He wanted it.
And then that was it.
I signed some paperwork, fucked my life over, and there you have the song.
So let's talk about
that. That's it in a nutshell.
Well, let's talk about that, because I remember the days where you and Chris were actually good friends and working and collaborating. How did it go from that?
Because that's the kind of guy I am. I have a real good heart, and I love real hard. So some of the stuff you see on Twitter is just, you know,
it's passion.
Passion, confused love, or me trying to get a reverse reaction out of somebody. Mm-hmm. And so, it works.
So what
not
happened?
Not with my baby mama. It don't work.
Well, let's talk. We're going to talk about Eva in a minute, but how did you and how
well,
did
I wasn't
you and Chris,
talking about her. I have two baby mamas.
Okay, but we're going to talk about Eva today. How did you and Chris go from Deuces to Deuces with just a middle finger?
Mm-hmm. He got on that bullshit, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Make a long story short, like, paperwork wasn't legit, and I kind of blame that on myself. Like, I kind of have to change the narration that I've been given. It's not a woe is me story. I signed it, but at the same time, it'll be like me bringing my partner in here and saying, look, you trust me, right? Sign this. And that's kind of what happened. Mm.
So in one of your interviews, I think you did with Vlad, you talked about him not wanting you to work with Keke Palmer. That's where it started to fall apart.
Vlad. One more time. What'd you say?
You said you hate Vlad?
He get on my nerves.
Okay, in the interview.
I just don't see why so many non-black people controlling black news or mm-hmm. black hip-hop stuff. We don't control nothing that we create. Mm-hmm. Starting back with jazz, rock and roll, and I could keep going.
So in that interview, you talked about you and Chris coming to heads over you wanting to work with Keke Palmer. And so is that where it really started, or do you feel like there was some envy between you two before that even came to play?
It started when Rihanna came in the studio. And he was playing my songs, and she kept saying, wait, we're going to get to your stuff. Play his again. Or is that you? That's him? Play his again. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, my goodness. Please do it, but don't do it. I don't know what to do. Mm-hmm. So it started way back then.
So you felt that Rihanna was choosing, just on the music?
She
was
it's good music is good music. You know what I'm saying? I like her music, too.
So you and Rihanna never had a sexual relationship, though?
No, never.
Did she ever try to pursue you, or you pursue her? Nothing.
No.
Okay.
Okay. So listen. So for our listeners,
I'm a shy guy. I don't really be choosing.
They choose like you.
They pick me. They have to show me that they're interested, and then I'll figure out a way to.
Is that kind of how the Beirucci song kind of came about? That there was a mutual kind of interest, because you know.
The Beirucci thing was kind of like just trying to piss him off, and it worked. And then she took it to the head, and I'm like, whoa. Knock it off.
Wait, reel that.
I don't like women that are built like preteens. Like, I like all shapes and sizes. Like, it's a difference between petite and
so
just
are you
like
saying
Karrueche's
like a little boy with makeup? Is that what you're saying?
You said it.
I didn't say that.
So I saw him, Vlad.
Didn't appreciate all that.
You and Chris met her at the same time, right? Around the same
not
time.
That we no. met her at the same time, but you know, she had a homegirl coming through.
Right.
I chose up on a homegirl, and Chris chose up on her.
Okay, so let's go back. Beirucci's like so far down the line.
Yeah,
let's
is.
Go back
the
to
song
where,
is dope.
So,
the song this
is
ain't
what
even
this is what
problem.
I'm trying to get.
I
hold
really
on,
like
hold
the
on.
Song.
There's a Thank lot you. Online that I'm trying to get to. So you guys were working together, you signed a CBE, you became Chris's producer/artist, right?
Swag stylist.
But in terms of music, artist
right.
and producer.
Right.
So you're producing music. How did it go from working cohesively to falling out? Was it just that you felt like maybe he thought you were hotter than him, so he put his thumb on you, or what was it?
I mean, honestly, I don't think a man could really stop you from doing anything. I think I was my worst enemy. I took the business too personal. Mm-hmm.
But he didn't release you from your contract, so he did something. He tried to, from what you were saying online, hold you hostage.
Yeah, but in hindsight, I got like five other labels. you know, battling over me right now. I do acting, other things. I don't really need a Chris Brown deal.
Okay.
I just did that to show the world, don't fuck with me.
Okay.
Because I can make you look stupid.
So for everybody who doesn't know your history, you are a really prolific songwriter. You have a ton of hits out there.
It's nice. You want a nice one.
I mean, we're listening to Deuces, which is one of the, like Jason said, the song that brought him back from the dead. But like, tell the audience some of your other major hits so that they know exactly what's happening here.
I wrote on Birthday Cake with The Dream for Rihanna.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote on Justin Bieber's Christmas album.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote, what is it called? Next Breath for Tank.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, I love that song. Yeah.
I have a crush on Brandy, but that's other news.
Okay.
No, we're going to get to all that. Here's the deal. I'm asking the questions that the people want to know.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I can Wikipedia.
People don't want to know questions.
No, people want to understand how the relationship became so toxic. And I've Google searched everything. I've read all the interviews. I've watched the YouTube interviews. I see it. I'm trying to still understand it. To your point, did he meet Karrueche at the same time? No, I introduced Karrueche to Chris with 12 other girls. He chose. I wanted her for Omarion. I've told the story. Omarion couldn't get it. He fell a little short. I don't know. Wasn't eating the groceries at the time. Chris got her. Okay.
Things happen.
So now they're working together. Y'all fall apart. There were some social media posts where basically you say he had to come and catch the fade. Is the fade still waiting for Chris Brown, or did y'all settle it?
Man, nobody want to fight me, man. And I don't want to fight nobody. I want to promote love, especially what's going on right now. I don't think anybody wants any kind of fades from the police or from me.
Okay.
Because they're both bad.
So, well, Chris kind of popped off on social media and said that, I mean, I don't know. He started doing the Piru thing. Because he's a gang member now, right?
I guess.
You're from Watts, right? So I'm from Chicago. I'm not from LA.
I'm from all over LA. Gardena, South Central, Inglewood.
But how do you feel about, like, it just seems like rappers and all these people that aren't from here, they're coming here and now they're, you know, they're Bloods, they're Crips, stuff like that. Like, how does that make you feel being somebody that's from the soil, that's from the culture, that you grew up with that around you?
You got to pay to play. I guess they paying to do something.
Mm-hmm.
When you get homeboys that get shot and you get guns put on you, you know, like this week, you know, and you got two daughters, the shit ain't cute. And it's stupid.
You had guns pulled on you?
Yeah.
Well,
lots of times this month.
Yeah, I mean, like, I just want to keep 1,000. Like, again, as a fan, I'm talking as a fan of music, fan of you, fan of Chris. I love Chris's music. I'm not necessarily a fan of him.
Do you like his perm?
I'm a fan of his music. I'm not.
Y'all
really
kind of had the same.
No, actually, my shit isn't texturized. My shit is just, I wake up and brush it and it's. Spray a little hold. I'm good. Hold on.
Okay.
So my question, very specifically, y'all fell out. I mean, you guys went online back and forth from "You Can Catch the Fade" to "You Ain't No Real Gangster" to "Pootie Boy" to, I mean, so many things that the fans read.
It's like after the Keke Palmer shit happened, I felt like he was hating, right?
Okay.
And I even got a text from his manager, like
Mike G.
No. His
Boom.
Old manager,
Boom.
A woman, and she was like, "Look, he told
Tina
us
Davis.
Not to fuck
Tina.
With you."
Okay.
And she showed me the text. So I was like, I'm going to sit on this for a minute because I got a bad temper. I'm going to try something new and not fuck up my career like I've been doing lately. And I just kind of sat on it for a minute and said, I'm going to just prove him wrong. You know what I'm saying? That's when the Keke Palmer shit had already happened. And I said, I'm going to just be a dope nigga and make him look stupid, you know?
When you say you think you've been fucking up your career lately, do you think it's because you've been honest about how you feel in your experiences? Because one thing, let me say this real quick. I feel like in this industry, and you've been around longer than us in terms of having a real professional career, you know, when you're going against a giant or a superstar, it's really hard to have your voice heard against that because you can be put in a box or you can be blacklisted.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I don't see you, having known you personally, I don't think you're crazy. I think right now you're saying a lot of crazy shit and being very descriptive on how you feel, but it's just real shit for you.
There's some cleverness to it, but at the same time, it's kind of like when two people are arguing from a distance, you can't tell who's crazy. So
that's true.
That's very, very true. I guess what we're looking for is, like, you know, the actual verbiage. So once you got the text, saw the text from his manager or former manager, whatever the case
Tina
is.
Tina Davis.
It was Tina Davis?
Yeah.
Really? Anyways, I'm going to skate right by that. That's just too much to go into.
His ex-girlfriend.
You saw, you motherfucker.
That's
anyways,
what you were thinking.
So you were hot-headed. once you cooled down, did you text him to address, like, yo, I saw the text. You're telling your team not to fuck with me. Like, what's up? Like, I don't understand. Was there that kind of exchange?
I didn't say anything. I just tried to, like, just kind of change the polarity of the whole situation. Just okay. Mentally, just bring a positivity. Just being a good person.
Okay, so how does it go from that to Chris, you know, filming his lifestyle, his cars, and saying, what's up, Kevin? I mean, you know, just basically poking the sleeping bear.
There was a tweet that Kevin sent out that basically said, I'm done being nice. I want you to let me out of my fucking contract.
Mm. And it goes right before that. But all that was a ploy to get him, because he won't talk on the phone. He won't handle any business. If you go through the lawyers, you know, that's legalese, some shit I don't speak, mm-hmm. but I'm learning. Amen. Mm-hmm. And it's some shit that just gets drawn out in court, and I hate court.
Mm-hmm. But so then it went from there to, when I see you, I got a fade waiting for you.
Yeah, I took it to the street politics, you know, mm-hmm. but not necessarily on some Crip and Blood shit, because then that's some whole other shit.
On some man, grown man shit, like, on some come man and see shit. Me as a man.
Yes. You know?
Do you think that'll happen?
Nah.
So y'all are never going to have hug it out? No hugging it out.
Man, we probably make some more hits. You know what I'm saying? Some more hits.
So you're willing to?
You know what I really think we should do? Wait, my mama.
Some more hits or some more hits?
We should do a charity boxing match or a UFC match. Like, we could go closed fists or gloves, and then we donate the money to, like, domestic violence. Like, he was convicted.
You are a comedian. Add convicted. That to the resume.
He was convicted for beating a woman. I was accused of beating a woman. I'm not guilty.
Not only did he accuse you of that, he also accused you of being a rapist as well, right, in one of his tweets. And then you sent out a picture of Rihanna, and
it's just a difference between accusations and you know.
You apologized for sending out that picture for Rihanna.
I didn't realize what I was pulling her out. And if that was my daughter, I would get mad again.
But you did that to remind him that we have receipts of you beating women.
Right.
You're trying to label me as
mine
something.
Is just some Girl Gone. You ever seen that movie, Gone Girl?
Gone Girl.
I'm on some shit like that. Mm-mm. Y'all don't have to believe me, but watch the movie. That's my life.
So Kevin, let's say you and Chris set up this charity boxing match, right?
Yeah.
How many rounds does this thing
go? Do it in
go?
Compton, because I'm really from there.
Okay. I'm
from Virginia.
All right, so we do it in Compton.
126 in Mona.
Uh-oh, let them know. How many rounds does it go? You knocking them out in the first round? Is this going
I'm not
distance?
In shape right now, so I'm going to just try to get it in three. You know what I'm saying? And I'm a brawler. I don't box. I never been a boxing type nigga. I'm just strong.
You're a street fighter.
Well, you know, this show is sponsored by the Money Team. He might need to sign with Mayweather Promotions.
I ain't no Kimbo or nothing. Like, I'm a pretty, you see, my face ain't been hit.
No scratches.
Because I win. I try not to.
So,
and if you keep fighting, you're going to meet that one nigga who wants to, you know, chip your
now,
head off.
Now, a lot of industry cats, they have these social media beefs, and it's like on site. And then it's
where just, those?
Okay, so now you bump into them on site. Who's swinging first, and does it even go there?
Have you guys ran into each other since all of this went down?
We haven't ran into each other since this went down.
Wow.
And I'd be everywhere by myself, but since that one situation happened, you know, I kind of try to walk around smarter. It ain't no fear type shit. It showed me, hey, maybe you're a star. It's dumb niggas are gonna try to fuck with you. You can't
so
just be.
The situation that you're discussing is when Karrueche had a hitman come for you.
It wasn't a hitman came for me.
I'm just summing it up.
So what happened? So there are reports that Karrueche had somebody pulled the gun on you because of Karrueche.
We finna clear this shit up. Wasn't no hitman, wasn't none of that. God damn. This is why I hate blogs.
What happened? You don't hate Hollywood Unlocked though, because we just report the facts.
Love you. Appreciate it. But basically, after I didn't even want to go out for BET Awards, but I went out for BET Awards. And after the club, I told my security go home. I left with two girls because I was hanging out with two girls. And they said, we're going to go to a private party where Odell Beckham is at. Not throwing you under the bus, bro. You just was there. That's why I went. So then when I get there, I don't really know whose house I'm at, but we're in Beverly Hills. You know what I'm saying? So I was like, it can't be too ghetto. You know what I'm saying? This ain't like house party five. Like,
right.
You know what I'm saying? So I feel real comfortable. My guard is down. Mm-hmm. I walk in. First person I see is this pretty petite little preteen, Karrueche, right? And she's sitting with a table full of stylists or something, right? So then I say, oh shit, I get goosebumps because I haven't seen her since I made Beirut.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering, like, I wonder if she does.
You sound
like
amazing
it.
On that song. By
you
me.
Really
that
do.
That song is dope.
Thank and you. I wouldn't I have taken offense all. To somebody making a song like that of me.
She's not offended. Trust me.
Okay.
Trust
tell,
me. She,
tell the story.
One time in the studio, her and her homegirl was grabbing my butt while I was trying to make beats, and I was like, look, I don't do that. I'm ain't gonna be no grabbing of the tushy.
No so, finger so. Banging over here.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So you walk in, You walk in.
Do that to your boyfriend.
You walk in the house. Beirut, she's sitting there with some stylists. Basically, right. What he's saying, she was there with a bunch of gay boys.
No, I didn't.
Okay. Were they gay boys?
I don't think so.
Were they boys?
They were boys.
They were gay boys. Okay, they were kids. So when you walk in and you see her.
Calls them the kids.
You get a little, whatever. So then what happens?
Butterfly.
Does she say hi to you?
I get nervous. And then so I don't walk all the way in. I'm like, I wonder what's going to happen. Everybody's looking at me. I'm thinking it's because of the song. So I'll continue to walk with my cocky ass. I continue to walk past them, right? And I walk. As soon as I walk past, they all go, what the fuck? What is this nigga doing here? I'm still not thinking, like, where am I at? I'm like, well, they're at the same party I'm at. I mean, because the night before I was at Tyree's house, some of the same people were there. You know what I'm saying? So I go to the back of the, I go to the backyard. And I'm just chilling. Everybody's stopping what they're doing and just looking, like, one by one. I'm like, what the fuck? Right? So I'm laughing. I'm thinking it's because of the Beirucci song. And then, like, four dudes and, like, red come up with red hats. And a big swole nigga, like, 230 come up. And he like, hey, you ain't welcome here, my nigga. Hey, take a walk with me. And I know what that mean. That we ain't finna go walk down memory lane. Like, we y'all finna try to jump me. So at that point, I'm trying to figure, okay, I can't run out the backyard. This Beverly Hills, it ain't made like that. I'm like, okay, let me try to brace the next blow. Is he going to try to sneak me from behind or what's going to happen? So four other dudes walk up and they trying to walk me to the door. So I try to get a little more space. So I walk a little fast. Then I walk past Karrueche. I had to look cool on that part. I
had to swag it on now.
And then I had to speed it back up. I try to get to the door, right? And then the big dude like, nah, like I said, you ain't welcome here. Matter of fact, who invited you here, homie? Like is the dude pulling up?
No, you're all good. Right. No, you're not being set up.
Because I've been trying to find him. I don't know who
he is. You're good.
Anyway, so I'm trying to go to the door. I said, you said I ain't welcome. I could let myself out. And it's four of y'all and one of me. I know how this going to go. Nope. So I go to the door, right? And he tried to lock it. He like, nah, hold up. Matter of fact. And then I opened the door. I pushed him out the way. I opened the door. And I had on my Omega Sci-Fi jacket. And I didn't have on no shirt because I was turned up at the club. Right? So when he tried to grab me, I came right out the jacket. And then I jumped over the gate, and then he pulled a gun. And his homeboy's like, no, don't shoot him right here. Don't shoot him. Mm. I hop over the gate. I run to Melrose. Or was it Beverly? I run to Beverly, and then I hop in the parking lot and hide under a car. And I call the girls who took me there. I'm like, did you motherfucker set me up?
Yeah.
I mean, at this point, it don't matter. Come get me.
Yeah.
I got to figure it out. So I had paranoia for a minute, but I gave it to God. And
wait, so do you think that happened as a direct result of the Beirucci song, or do you think that was Chris's people that were there around Karrueche?
I've been going through that my whole damn life. Like, I think it's just like the light that's on me and the calling that's on me, but I learned how to control it with my mentality.
So how did the rumor get started that it was Karrueche that set these
guys? He sent out a tweet.
She was there, so it has to be her friend.
So he sent out a tweet.
And I still don't know where I was at.
Kevin sent out a tweet that that basically Karrueche had set him up for somebody to shoot him.
No, I didn't.
What was
I was talking to her because a lot of times when I speak, it's not for everybody else. It's for who it's intended for. And sometimes it might be that one person. I look crazy to everybody else for that one person to get what I'm saying. And I was telling her, you know who it was because you was right there. You was watching.
And you said you went and got a piece after this incident?
No, yeah, I went and got a pretty girl. You know, I like models, okay. So I got me a diamond.
You got to clear. Hold on. But what he said was some fake thugs pulled a gun on him for the Karrueche comments.
Yeah, because that's a fake thug to me. Like, I ain't never, I really know thugs. I know Pyrus, Bloods, everything, because my cousins are all that. You know, I'm from L.A. Mm-hmm. So my family is literally everything. So I don't get into all that. I'm a gospel singer, but he was trying to take me there, and I almost went there. You know, it's finna get ugly in the streets.
I mean, Otis Redding and Sam Cooke never had these problems.
No, they fucking
R&B
did not.
Beef
so
is real.
Has Karrueche responded to any of this?
She hasn't said anything.
She hasn't said a word.
Publicly.
Okay. All right.
That's funny, too. Like, I mean, speak up.
And when you made Beirucci, what was the whole thought process behind that, the concept?
To annoy Chris?
To annoy Chris, but make it fun, make it romantic and clever, turn women on. Turn Karrueche on. Let her know. Stop playing. You like Tyson. I'm the Watts Tyson. Let's get it popping.
But does she really like Tyson? Back for it.
Yeah.
I almost called her Beirucci. Karrueche's actually a friend of mine, so I don't want. I'm not being disrespectful.
She used to always say, "You look like Tyson." Oh my God, K-Mac, you look like Tyson.
And her and Tyson were hanging out for a little while. I don't know that they were messing around or anything, but they were definitely hanging out.
That's him, man. So who else you gonna hook me up with this time?
Well, I hooked you up with Jordin, and clearly you don't want to claim her publicly. So
she like Jason Derulo, and I don't put on baby oil and pop.
So how far? how far did you and Jordin go?
You want me to really tell it?
I want you to really tell it.
She gonna kill me for this.
That's okay.
I let her sit on my face.
Wow.
That's it. And it tastes like water.
I will tell you this. There was definitely no air in that fucking situation.
Fiji.
So I hooked you up with Bria Miles, too. Where did
Sorry,
that go?
Jason.
Well, Jason's moved on. He hooked up with Daphne Joy. May she rest in peace, too. So now, I hooked you up with Bria Miles. Where'd that go?
No, you didn't.
I introduced you guys.
She didn't like me because I was broke. She took me. I took her to Grand Lux. I barely had enough money for the deal.
This is why I like
that
Kevin.
That was like...
I'm going to tell you why I like Kevin. Kevin is a Leo. And he's a creative Leo. Mm-hmm. And,
I'm from Compton.
And I thought you were from Watts.
Watts, Compton.
Oh, is it the same thing?
Cardina, Carson.
My car shuts really off past Wilshire, so I don't really know anything other than Hollywood. Shout out to the homie here. Keep your eye on him.
I've been watching him.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I got my like, taking
you
no
see was in his ear. Didn't have no shame exactly. in his game. God damn, no, so, Obama could have been
so
here.
So Kevin just shared how Jordin sat on his face. Why didn't you guys ever continue to build that relationship? I mean, she needs a hit, and you got him.
You ain't going to believe me if I tell you the answer, but I'm going to tell you.
Tell me.
My manager at the time, who wasn't a manager, he was just my big brother who was pretending to be my manager.
Okay.
And we was trying to figure out the music game, hence why we signed to Chris Brown. He told me, hey, K-Mac, you still in your player shit? Don't fuck her over, because that Jason Lee is going to fuck you over in the media. He going to call you a playboy.
I would never.
And your career going to be over.
I've never, listen, so I
cut it off with her.
I get a bad rap because whenever you think about bloggers, you think media take
you out. Told me not to break her heart, though. That's
I did
you
tell
said.
You that. I'm a fucking good guy. I wish
you
people,
are. He is. So he is such a good guy.
I am
and so,
so
I didn't break my heart. Where's my credit?
You didn't break her heart, but you may have broke her.
Sherry?
Yeah. I was trying to think of the female anatomy, not my expertise. I just don't know.
Let's do it, man.
But anyway, okay, so let's talk about women. You, I remember I did the Trayvon Martin campaign. You and Eva Marcil were one of the first people to come and shoot. Yes. One of the best pictures from that
My
campaign.
Child's mom.
It was gorgeous.
Amazing picture.
Absolutely
they both
gorgeous.
Style, swag. I mean, and that was at the time where you had told me she was pregnant at that shoot. She had just gotten pregnant. And I had joked with them. I was just like, you know y'all going to have a baby. They're like, ha, ha, ha. Then the next time I saw them, they were with the child. Mm-hmm. So... y'all have gone from that to you and her fighting it out publicly. I think she got a restraining order. What happened?
My temper, you know, I hit things, I break things. So when the whole calling the police thing happened, the evidence was my tantrum. You know what I'm saying? Even though I didn't do what she said, the evidence was the
What did
door.
She say? Because, the, said, because there was the I mean, accusation
you, you,
that you...
You could look it up. She said I chased her. She You could even... To make a long story short, she said I put her and the baby at harm, which is something I would never do. Mm-hmm. But one thing I learned from going to therapy, which I've been doing with Iyanla Vincent and just, you know, other people like that, I've learned just how I could get myself out of those situations and how I can control my temper to not be in these situations.
Okay, so there was a situation where you saw photographs of Eva's brother, I want to say, with your little girl, and you went
the fuck
off on Twitter. You basically...
Well, it's a couple of things y'all talking about, and y'all lumping them together, so I'm going to help y'all there. I'm going to do
it
fast.
Okay, thank you.
So you might be talking about Terrell, which is her cousin.
Okay.
And I was talking about a picture with, like, him and his boyfriend kissing my baby. You know, I don't get to kiss her. I don't want y'all kissing her. It has nothing to do with none of that. I don't let my sisters kiss her.
That was something completely different.
Let me be fair and set it up that you and I have been friends for a long time. I don't know you to be homophobic or to be uncomfortable with gay people.
Right.
We're good friends. Mm-hmm. So just kind of throw that out there because I think it's easy.
So it annoys me when people say that.
When a person goes on a rant or when a person says something, you know, you've had your words dissected.
Yeah.
You can take somebody's words and try to paint this picture. I know... Kevin is a friend, and I know he's not homophobic.
Right.
There was a photo with Terrell, and he had said something about, I think he called himself daddy or something like that.
I don't like that shit.
Hold on. And we said this shit before. No. The other day I was at Floyd's house, and we were talking about Sierra marrying Russell Wilson and letting Russell kiss him on the mouth and call him Papa.
Yeah, call him Papa.
You gonna send a black man into pure rage. Mm-hmm. Especially if they love their child and they're active in their child's life. So that's kind of what I look like happened with you.
That's what happened with me.
And, with Terrell.
That's what happened. And you know, I have to take you to the new me. You know, the old me, I was pissed. I was like, I don't really get to see my baby. I mean, I'm broke as fuck, so I can't pay a lawyer to go see my baby. What kind of world is this? You know, that's the kind of level I was operating on. But now I'm going back to what they taught me. It take a village to raise a child. And that's true, because it's areas in my life I got great parents, but they fucked up a lot. You know, I got a great daddy, worked with probation kids. I still ended up in jail. I got a great mom. She's a, you know, Bible school teacher. You know, she still let me down in some areas. You know, I still got molested as a child, shit like that. So it's like everybody had their faults, and you just got to grow from it and learn.
Okay, well, speaking on that, I was going to address the whole, you know, cousin and homophobic rant, you know, that you were accused of. But no, her brother, there was something else there where you basically went on a rant of, this is the same motherfucker you said molested you, and you're going to have my daughter around him? Are you crazy? And so how did that start and end up? Where is that? And what about the accusations?
You just got to go back to me. In terms of the truth, you got to go back to me doing the whole woe is me narrative. Right. Like, I don't have communication with her. I don't have communication with these people. So I project my thoughts or stuff out in the media so that y'all talk about it, or they homies, somebody gonna, you gonna hear about it, goddamn.
And it'll make sure they get the word.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Or somebody gonna know the fuck shit you doing. If I really did hit you, I would have went to jail. You know what I'm saying? So why am I not seeing a baby? I'll go to the police station and get the baby or whatever. It's fuck shit. Let's just leave it alone. It's cause I didn't marry you.
But you just mentioned, all you just shared, which is something very personal. I was molested as a child. You were molested. Was there a part of you that personalized the fact that she had shared something to you that you could relate to?
I didn't even know I could relate to it, you know, at the time. It was something I hid until recently. You know, I didn't even know about it.
What made you, how did you discover it?
Because I've been going to therapy, and I
so it was repressed memories?
It was repressed memories, and I realized why I'm so, I hate authority and why I'm so controlling and why I don't want my daughters around people. Without me being around, because I can't protect them and stop them from going through what I went through.
And this is what I think is so frustrating too, especially knowing people that are celebrities or that are in the public eye like you. Like, they're human beings. Celebrities are human beings. And I think when you strip away what you see online or what you see on social media, human beings find their own creative ways of making people get the point. There was a point where I was a heavy drinker, and I used to literally whatever I felt came the fuck out on my social media. And I got labeled crazy, messy, this, that.
That's now, where the labeling comes from, is
But now I'm on the money team. I'm popping. Okay, so fuck. So
loan me $5.
No, so I told Floyd about you last night. I did say I wanted to introduce you to Floyd. The money team. Shout out to the Money Team music group. I'm definitely gonna make that
fuck because with the money team.
At the end of the day, regardless of like the online antics or politics or rage or whatever, you are very talented. And you did resurrect the career of somebody who's humanly flawed and socially flawed, and in many ways has not even reached his fullest potential. So I mean, listen, I'm just a real motherfucker,
and also might be responsible for getting in his own way. You know, like
Chris Brown is absolutely in his own way.
He's on his own worst enemy.
You know, and shout out to Joyce and everybody that are trying to help him. But at the end of the day, as you know, you can't be helped until you're ready to help yourself.
And sometimes it just seems like we like twins or some shit. Like we could learn a lot from each other. And it's like I dropped the ball the first time around because I had a lot of fears. Like, I came from the hood, and I was around all you Hollywood people. I had never seen that. I was playing football. I mean, I was finna play for the Raiders.
And you got thrusted into some shit.
So the shit was weird, man. Yeah. So
Kevin, therapy is working for you. You are so
like night and day.
He's just
no. But let me say this. Knowing Kevin personally and in person, he's always to me been like this. I've never seen the social media Kevin it's that different. I read. And I
learned a lot more about myself since
I ain't gonna lie. I did text him a couple times like, "Yo, bro, want to interview?" You know, and he was like, "I ain't fucking with you."
This goes beyond diplomacy. Like, it's just like it's a lot of personal growth that I can hear just from the way that you're just talking. You know, it's there's a real dichotomy between the people, you know, what people think they know about you and really who you are. And I feel like this is the realest interview you've ever given. Everything else has been, you know. Just like sugar and, you know, whatever.
Exactly.
But this is.
I've been sugarcoating shit.
Yeah. Do you ever wish that you would have stayed the football route at all?
Man, lately, I've been wanting to play. I was looking at some highlights yesterday. Not my highlights, but I was looking at highlights. But I'm like, what can I really do? Like,
What position did you play? You play running back?
I play running back.
Yeah.
Well, so, you know, we talked about you and Eva the other day when we were at the Occupy City Hall event. You were there. Eva was there. Mm-hmm. Interestingly
enough. Talk?
Wait, no. Lance Gross was also there.
That's hilarious.
I told my camera guy, I said, listen, I want to interview him.
Triangulate.
Him and her, but keep the camera on all three of those.
Triangulate that situation.
Shit might go down.
Get that wide shot.
You know, and I'm just for the record, I'm cool with everybody. You know, I mean, who knows after this interview?
Lance is happily married right now. He just took his wife on a birthday cruise.
Shout out to my HU brother, Lance, man.
Shout out to Lance.
Shout out to Lance.
So where are you and Eva now?
I mean, y'all waves twins.
So you and Eva now are co-parenting. How do you co-parent? You don't communicate, or do you communicate through a third party?
It's just a big difference between a father and a man with kids. Right now, I'm operating as a man with kids because I haven't went through the court process to get my children from out of the grasp of whatever she's doing. I haven't got all the knowledge, but I'm leaning toward. I'm back and forth with it because I got to get my license. A nigga L's is dirty, shit like that.
So
like,
you're just getting it all together.
Getting all together so that when I do go to court, I'll just get my babies and we good.
So do you and Eva talk at all?
I mean, I talk to her. I make songs about her. Try to talk to her like that. Send it to her.
I saw that Instagram post that you sent. Was Instagram or tweet that you sent out? Like, it's very complimentary. Mm. It was a beautiful picture of Eva, and you basically were, you know, giving her props.
She's cute. It's hard to, you know, forget about her. She's so fun.
It's hard to stay mad at that, huh?
Do you ever miss your relationship with her?
I just cherish the things I learned from it. It was, at first I thought it was like love lost, but now I cherish that time.
You're a Leo, and she's a Scorpio.
Right. And I'm a Scorpio rising.
Oh my God. We get along.
We're just not fucking.
That's why we get along, because we're not fucking. It will never happen.
I think we'll get along. I think me and you will get along.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Before Kevin walked in there, I said, this is the only show in history that we will not talk about your vagina or try to hook you up on a date. And it's like, and every time we have a man in the studio,
it just happens.
Some type of energy happens. I need to learn that from you.
It's that mother nurturing kind of thing that I've got going on.
Some type of Jason Lee.
So when you ate Jordin Sparks' pussy,
hi,
or she sat on your face. Yeah, well, that's the same thing.
Well, that's what Q dogs do. You know I'm a Q.
No, but
oh, goddamn. He's a Leo and a Q.
Is Jordin Sparks a closet freak, or is she like...
She has nipple rings, don't she?
I didn't know.
I mean, are women with nipple rings freaks, or...
Do you think I'm a freak, Jason?
I think so.
I don't know. I have a couple people I need to call for that answer. Mm. I won't say their name on air.
I did have a nipple ring, but my nipple rejected it.
So was she
supposed to be rejecting? It's like credit. Like,
I know I liked it.
Need a 720.
Let me leave Jordin Sparks alone, because she and Joe are going to be upset at me for asking the question. But it's good to know that. See, this
probably
is
happy.
This goes back to
it's you an can honor be to a, sit on my face.
You can be an American Idol and still get your pussy ate.
Yes, you can.
Okay. So
by watch nigga.
So it's really hot in here.
So this is going to be an interesting transition, but I'm going to try it.
Go do it.
Segue. After everything that's been said and done between you and Eva or your other baby mamas.
Okay.
What do you want your daughter or your children to know and understand about their father?
That their father was like just a boy who had to make a transition to manhood. I didn't have a quinceañera or a bar mitzvah.
Said a quinceañera.
You know,
we hope you don't
as a black man, we don't have that transition to manhood. But as I seek help after fucking up, you know, with my family, I found myself. You know, hopefully I get a chance to get them back. But I learned sometimes people reach their goddamn limit, and you just gotta let them grieve how they gonna grieve. But hopefully they see I'm a new me.
So if we put all the politics aside, all the drama, all the social media stuff, all of that aside, what do you want?
I love that.
What do you want out of your relationship with Chris Brown, ultimately?
I just want him to respect himself. When you respect yourself, you respect everybody else.
Do you guys feel like you made a really good team, you know, in terms of like,
Yeah, because like it was a lot of times where I had that fear. And I think that's what he was trying to talk about in the video. He didn't do it very well. He's not that articulate, and he got that lisp going on like Charlamagne. But, you know, he wanted me to be a lot more forceful. Mm-hmm. And I think he used my little trick that I used on him. He used it on me. He brought the bulldog out of me. Mm-hmm. And it's funny, like growing up, my dad was my football coach, and he used to call me bitch or sock me or do whatever in football practice to make me fuck everybody else up. So sometimes people do that to make me mean.
Do you ever get concerned about Chris's safety or his life, that maybe one day we'll see another Michael Jackson, another Whitney Houston or something like that?
My worst fear is that it's partially my fault. You know, I already dropped the ball the first time. Then I tried the Martin Luther King shit. It made me pissed. So then I went Malcolm X. And then I saw kids looking at me. And I was, some of them liked it. But at the same time, I saw it was so many people watching me. And I was like, fuck, I can't get this nigga killed, like, and I don't want to get killed. Like, this is stupid. Like, I could change this shit. I could be the one to change it. And I am. So I see it's changing it, honestly.
Can you see a day where you and Chris come together and make some more hits?
Definitely, man. Like, who's some good people that got together and back in the day? Did Dr. Dre and Snoop get back?
Did they? Yeah. I can't remember. They did, right?
I just watched Straight Outta Compton. I didn't see that.
Yeah, I was watching it yesterday.
I don't know.
I have no idea.
If Destiny's Child.
But you know what? I will also say that, you know, I live by one of my.
You're and that's the other thing. We're not a group either. Like,
yeah.
He could take a song. That was my other thing I used to tell people, like, he can get a song whenever, or we could collaborate, whatever. I collaborate with bums on the street, literally. Mm. Like, I used to be on Skid Row making songs with bums.
So are you still signed to CBE?
I am not signed to CBE as a artist.
Okay.
But he has paperwork that, you know, we handle in court.
Okay. So I guess the question would be, I mean, at least for me, the way I live my
he's
life.
Still being a bitch ass nigga, if that's what you want.
Huh?
He's still being a
Oh, no. What I was going to say was, thank you for clarifying. What I was saying, like, for me, one of my rules for life, literally, whether it's work, love, partnerships, anything, is life does not go in reverse. It just is not set up to work that way. You don't read a book backwards. You don't watch a movie backwards. We don't drive backwards. Life is all about moving forward.
Progressing.
So maybe the question isn't, do you think you'll ever work with Chris again? Because that chapter's already happened. Mm-hmm. So what's next for Kevin McCall?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, my whole life.
Money Team Music Group.
Yeah, maybe. I'm definitely going to do some stuff with Floyd. I've always been a fan of him. Like I said, I'm going to Vegas to turn up the whole weekend, get away from this music shit, get away from L.A., get away from the hood, and turn the fuck up. I'm probably running to Florida. Is he out there?
He's out there. Maybe
put in the car for him.
Maybe we can set something up. I'll see where Red is. Yeah. Okay, so did you have another question?
Yeah. No, I was just going to say, like, you know, just in terms of shutting everything down. I mean, you're going to go to Vegas. You're going to turn up. But, like, how do you just kind of quiet the noise in your head? Because I'm sure there's a lot, you know, like, you know, I don't want to, like.
I smoke marijuana.
Alrighty then.
I self-medicate. That's all right. Myself.
Nice.
So does she.
Right, but it's not good for your looks.
If they follow your Snapchat, motherfuckers know you high, stretching all the yum and shit.
I wouldn't know that you smoke.
Oh,
your lips are too pretty. Like, I wouldn't think that.
You. Like a chimney.
Thank you.
Okay, well, listen, I will wrap by saying that, you know, cool. I learned a lot in this city about calling people friends. I don't even do it no more. If you look at how I was back when we first met versus now, I don't even have a circle.
I used to get on you about that.
I know.
You can't have that fair rejection.
But I will say, I'm a true friend of yours. I do appreciate you. And we're going to figure out how to get things together. And however I can help, however we can help, we definitely want to. Because Kevin, absolutely, no doubt, makes great music. And the world needs that. All this R&B beef shit, I mean, whether it's you fighting Chris or fighting his demons or your demons fighting his demons, like, the world needs good music, whether it's through Chris or somebody else. So
I absolutely agree. Thank you so much for stopping by, Kevin.
Wait, one thing. Yeah? Where the fuck can we find you? Because somebody deactivated some of your social media accounts.
I was putting up too much, like, Black Lives Matter type shit. This is a true story. I was putting up too much.
It was mixed
between that and the Team Breezy shit. It got deleted.
So where did we find you now?
At I Am Kevin McCall, though, T-H-O.
And that's on Instagram?
That's on Instagram. And you can find everything.
Twitter's the same.
Twitter's the same for the most part. I mean, if you just search Kevin McCall... My Instagram is the most important thing because I send it to every other thing.
Okay, I am Kevin McCall, though.
Yes. And follow me on my Snapchat because that's where you see my playful side. I want to show people I'm a big clown. I'm a big kid.
See, Jason doesn't understand that that's what I'm trying to do with my Snapchat.
The real you.
But you got to do it a certain way. No shade to my boo. I love you, Brandy, but your Snapchats be weird. I'd be like...
What does she do on her Snapchat?
I'm sorry. I totally forgot something. Are you and Brandy fucking or is that just...
No.
You guys are just... That was just playing
that's
for social
my
media.
Friend. Like,
okay. I love Brandy.
What's going down on her
like
Snapchat?
Like, how she's going to be my friend.
No, because him and Brandy, they were rumored to be dating. And, you know, almost doesn't count. So I didn't know if they were dating or not.
I like her voice.
Maybe she's his best friend or baby. I don't know.
I'm a huge fan of Brandy's music.
I'll just be sitting up in her room.
I was just about to say that. Hopefully she's not sitting on your face like Jordin was. But anyway, thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you so much, Kevin.
Thanks, Kev.
Bye.